Alright, good morning, YTPC. Broadcast coming from the sunny Caribbean. The most southern part of the sunny Caribbean, actually. Getting a Caribbean broadcast today, so you've got a nice sort of tropical shirt. In the background, we've got Merry Men music playing. The Merry Men were from Barbados, very popular in the 60s, 70s. You can find the music on YouTube, on iTunes if you like it. But anyway, I'm just going to turn this down a little bit. And we're drinking a little bit of rum. The doctor told me to cut back. He said one glass a day would be good. That would be okay, one glass. So here's my one glass of rum for the day, Doc. Cheers to you. Bottoms up. Have to find a new doctor. Anyway, today we'll start off with a little quotation that I love. Aut viam inveniam, aut faciam. It means I shall either find a way or make one. The links to it will be put in the show notes. My Latin is pretty terrible. I only did it for 2 years. When I was a boy at school, Latin was mandatory. And actually, before that, like when my father was a boy at school, both Latin and Greek were mandatory. And in those days, most people from the Caribbean went to England or Ireland if they wanted to study medicine or law. And they had to know Greek and Latin to get into medical school or law school. Anyway, here's a special little shout out with a note for Miss Skeeter. Miss Skeeter seems to like Cope's Escudo. I came across her videos this morning. Very interesting lady. And she refers to these little things as coins, which is actually quite true. This was told to be my father, and then I researched it this morning. As we know, the rope tobaccos were used by the sailors to keep the tobacco from drying out, and they'd slice off a little piece and stick inside their pipes. Probably more than likely the clay pipes. But as Mesquita said, she called them coins, and here's the reason why. Escudo was a Portuguese coin. It was used in the Portuguese colonies in South America, Asia, and Africa. Today, the only country that uses escudo as a currency is Cape Verdean. Cape Verdean. I'll put the link for that in the show notes if anyone is interested. By the way, this is a Savinelli. It was a pipe of the year 1995. And when I bought it, I wondered why the hell did I buy it, because I didn't like it. And of late, it has actually become very much a favorite of mine, and I've started smoking it. I've only smoked it about twice before since 1995. Now, I'm going to give you some little tips I've learned about tobacco, cellaring tobacco, and keeping them in good order. I think I've only ever had one tobacco go bad on me. And I used to have a skill and it died, and I managed to pick up one on Friday. More to that story after. This was actually very reasonable. It cost me $91 in our currency, less than $14 US. Now, the first scale I had only went to one decimal, one place before the decimal point. This one goes to three, which is much more accurate for what I'm going to suggest you use it for, other than tobacco blending. It also has a very nice feature. This one gives you the temperature in Celsius, which I really don't need to know because I live right by the equator. We only have two temperatures here. In the dry season, it's hot and humid, and in the rainy season, it's very hot and very humid. You don't need to buy a crock pot. You just put the meat in your shorts, and within a few hours, you have crotch pot cooking. Anyway, so here's a little tip. Very often, we buy canisters to store tobacco in. These I picked up on Friday too. What I liked was the handle, because I'm a clumsy sod and I drop everything, so with the handle a less chance of me dropping it. And these were about $3.25 US, so $22 in our currency. Now, very often we use various canisters, the canning jars, whatever, to store tobacco, but we are not sure how airtight they are. And there's a simple test. You take one of these units, or whatever unit you're using, and you fill it with water. You weigh it on the scale. I use a piece of Scotch tape or sellotape if you're English, and just put it right on it the date I measured it and what the measurement was in either grams or ounces. And then about a month or two, I'll come back and take the same bottle, put it on the scale, and that way I'll know if it's losing a lot of moisture. So I'll know whether it's worthwhile to use it to store tobacco or not. Another one I thought of, I haven't actually done this one myself, but I thought of doing this, was if you blend a tobacco, or you buy bulk tobacco and put it in here and seal it, once again, just use a bit of Scotch tape and write the date and how much it weighed. And 2 months later, you can just put it on your scale without opening it up to let in more air and see if it has gone off drastically. So you can check if your tobacco is losing moisture without having to open the canister. Of course, if it's losing, you'd open it up and moisten it however you do, whether it's water, which is, as far as I'm concerned, the only thing you should use in tobacco, or whatever, sugar water, or whatever you want to use. So that's my little tip on keeping your tobaccos fresh. Now, whenever I read tobacco reviews, they always tell you how the tobacco burns, if it burns down to whatever, ash or so forth. And I always thought, who gives a rat's ass about what ash the tobacco burns down to and what color? Now, we live in a politically correct world, so I better not use the term rat's ass. I should say rodent's rectum. I mean, we don't want to offend any snowflake rodents out there. James Cagney would not have been able to say that line you dirty rat in his movie into this politically correct world. Actually, that's misquoted. That's not what he really said. And once again, I'll put a link to the correct term he used. But being politically correct, we shall say rodents rectum instead of rat's ass. And anyway, back to tobacco ash and why it's important. I normally go to Mass on a Saturday afternoon. And when I went out on Friday to buy scale and the canister, I use what I normally wear once I'm not riding a motorcycle. And when I'm riding my motorcycle, I wear jeans, but I have not been riding of late for health reasons. But anyway, I use a short pants that's loose enough that I can put my pipe in it when I go into a store, when I have to go into the whatever vehicle is in transport. And anyway, I came home, took off the short pants I was wearing, hung it up, and then early Saturday morning I said, hey, let me do a load of clothes. I could wash my church pants, so I'll have a nice clean pants to go to church this afternoon. And I threw what else was in the laundry basket, including the short pants I'd used the day before. And all I know is that the pipe must have turned on its side in the pocket of the pants, and pipe ash was all over my clean laundry. It was a holy mess. I had to clean out even the washing machine drum and redo the laundry. So between tobacco ash and whatever tobacco was left there, juice, it really made a mess of things. And therefore, as far as I'm concerned, that's the only reason I really need to worry about what color ash is at the bottom of my tobacco. Sorry to offend any of you aficionados of your reviews, but to me that's worthless information. Finally, today I'm making, or I'm attempting to make for the very first time, roast lamb. I'm a big meat eater. When I say meat, I mostly beef and pork. Here in Trinidad, people are chicken eaters, a lot of people like duck or goat. Part of the reason is we have a big Hindu and a big Muslim population, and therefore the Hindus won't eat anything with beef, and the Muslims won't eat anything with pork. It's actually quite funny, you go into a Chinese restaurant owned by Muslims, and then there are no pork products in the Chinese menu. And right next door, they'll have a Hindu another Chinese restaurant run by Hindus, and they have no beef products in their menus. But to hell with them. I am a beef eater. So, as I said, I'm trying for the very first time today to make a roast lamb. It's marinating. I'll cook it later tonight. So, wish me luck with that. While we are on the topic of meat eating, to me, the vegans are just as bad as the anti-smoking Nazis. They're always in your face telling you what to do, yada, 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 yada. I'm sorry, we all gonna die. So I'm gonna eat what I like anyway. I could eat lettuce and tofu for my whole life, but I'm still gonna land up in the same place as someone that eats beef and pork. So I'm going to eat my beef and pork. And My little pet peeve. Just finished a book last night. I was telling Father Padre Piper about it. Gonna put a link to it too. I do a lot of books, listen to a lot of audiobooks, and I'm going to do a podcast on how I think audiobooks are great with pipes. Sorry, not a broadcast. Anyway, the name of this book is Beneath a Scarlet Sky, and it's basically about a priest uses some youngsters, like between 16 and 18, 19, in Italy during the war to rescue Jews, and these boys take them over the Alps to save them. There's one character in particular who was the focus of the book. For me, they had some very interesting other tie-ins in the book. The one of the other main characters, Cardinal Schuster, he was actually known personally to Pope John Paul II. And when Cardinal Schuster died, Pope John Paul, before he was Pope, was one of his pallbearers. Another interesting tie-in book for me is I'm very much into motorsport, especially Formula One. Oh, I used to be. I still like it, but I really don't get a chance to follow it. But I like Formula One, the history of it, and so forth. And the hero in the book was trained to drive by Alberto Ascari, who was an Italian Formula One driver, drove for Ferrari, and a world champion twice, I think. And then came across that the guy, the hero of the book, also had personal knowledge or knew the following people, which were American Formula One drivers before they became Formula One drivers: Dan Gurney, Phil Hill, Richard Guthrie. And for me, this was great because a lot of these people were my boyhood heroes. And finally, it was quite startling. At the end of the book, there was also a tie-in to meerschaum pipes. So there was a lot of interest for me in that book. But I thought it was one of the best books I ever read. Not necessarily in the writing style, but in the story and the message behind the book. Parts of it are very sad, I will warn you. But I strongly suggest, if you're looking for an interesting book to read on the strengths and frailties of human beings, have a look at this book. It also is a good book from the point of view where people are always bashing the Catholic Church, that shows that the Catholic Church is not the big monster that everyone makes it out to be. So as I said, I'll put the links to this book, which I thoroughly enjoyed, and I'm sure I'm going to read it more than once, or listen to it more than once. And let's end off with my disclaimer. Unfortunately, no vegans were hurt in the making of this video, but I'll do better next time. Have a great day, everyone. Cheers to the YTPC community. All the best, John.